Boa tarde a todos. Meu nome é Mariana, eu sou gerente de comunicação do GIF e eu quero dizer que é um enorme prazer estar com vocês aqui nesse momento, não só por ser um bloco de comunicação dentro do Congresso do GIF, que já é uma super novidade, um avanço para o tema, então a gente fica muito feliz com isso, mas também para contar para vocês que esse momento ele representa o lançamento de uma rede que a gente organizou e que esse momento agora é o próprio lançamento da rede, que se chama Narrativas. É uma rede de comunicadores de organizações da sociedade civil. E a gente está muito feliz em dizer que, a partir desse momento, todos estão convidados a participar. Quem faz parte dessa rede no momento, quem constituiu a rede foi o GIF, o Alana, o Instituto CA, Instituto Unibanco, a Cause, Fundo Brasil de Direitos Humanos, a Pop Comunicação, a Fundação Maria Cecília Souto Vidigal, mas a gente quer convidar todo mundo para participar. A ideia é fazer com que a gente consiga mostrar cada vez mais o potencial da comunicação dentro das organizações e mostrar como a comunicação é uma peça-chave para a transformação social. Para esse lançamento, a gente aproveitou alguns dados do Censo, que é uma pesquisa do GIF, que eu não sei se todo mundo conhece, mas a gente faz a cada 2 anos, com os nossos associados. E a pesquisa ela é respondida por 90% dos associados, e a gente pegou o bloco de comunicação para entender um pouco como os investidores sociais se comunicam. E tem alguns dados interessantes que a gente quis trazer para vocês. Então, primeiro, a gente pergunta, quando você pergunta para um associado, para um investidor social, você acha a comunicação importante? Na maioria dos casos, eles respondem, sim, nossa, a comunicação é muito importante e tal. Mas aí, quando você vai um pouquinho mais a fundo na pesquisa, nas perguntas um pouco mais para frente, você começa a perceber algumas questões que nos levantaram alguns alertas. Então, primeiro, se você pergunta para a organização qual que é seu público, as organizações responderam assim que, e esse número cresceu da pesquisa anterior para agora, que 83% dos associados responderam que o público deles de comunicação é a sociedade civil em geral. Quem trabalha com comunicação sabe que sociedade civil em geral não é público, Você não pode achar que todo mundo é o seu público. Então, isso já é uma questão que nos acendeu um alerta de como a gente precisa começar a trabalhar essa comunicação dentro das organizações. Outro dado que a gente nos surpreendeu é que, quando a gente pergunta quais os objetivos que elas almejam com as ações de comunicação, chamou muito a atenção a multiplicidade de objetivos que as organizações têm. Então, foram trazidos pelo menos 8 objetivos. 8. Assim, a gente já sabe que, quando a gente tem uma comunicação para fazer, uma campanha, um projeto, qualquer coisa, um objetivo já é difícil. Imagina 8. Então, as principais, alencados por ordem, mas, em primeiro lugar, saiu dar visibilidade aos programas e projetos. Segundo, construir redes e relacionamentos. Terceiro, garantir maior transparência às ações. E, em quarto lugar, informar, mobilizar, engajar beneficiários ou comunidades envolvidas. Isso para a gente, para a rede, conversando com os associados e com os envolvidos, isso foi um alerta. A gente falou, aí tem um espaço para a gente discutir. Porque quando você coloca mobilizar em quarto lugar, você tá deixando de lado a oportunidade de transformar o seu conteúdo em mensagem. Então, para você construir uma mudança, a mudança que você está querendo, faz parte do, você fazer com que ela faça parte do seu repertório estratégico, você tem que entender que, assim, todo o potencial científico, técnico, acadêmico que você tem nos seus projetos, ele tem que ser transformado em linguagem. Você tem que saber comunicar, você tem que conseguir passar aquilo que você está fazendo em forma de mensagem. Então, mobilizar e transformar e comunicar, a gente ficaria muito feliz se a gente tivesse visto essa resposta em primeiro lugar. A gente percebeu muito que os associados estão usando a comunicação, a gente supôs um pouco, mas, enfim, que essa comunicação está sendo usada como prestação de contas. E prestação de contas, a gente sabe que dá para ir muito além disso. Então, a gente acha que, Você precisa conseguir irradiar o que você está produzindo para os gestores, para os formuladores, para a opinião pública. Você precisa conseguir colocar para fora aquilo que você está fazendo de um jeito leve, de um jeito gostoso, que comunique, que mobilize e que toque os corações e as mentes das pessoas. Então, eu preciso tocar o imaginário independente do que eu estou fazendo. E eu acho que existe a gente acredita que existe um enorme potencial para isso. Para esse lançamento, a gente tem um videozinho que é o Manifesto da Rede que a gente está lançando, que a gente quer mostrar agora em primeira mão para vocês. Pode passar.
Você já contou por quantas fontes se informa diariamente? Vivemos a era da hiperconectividade. O avanço das tecnologias está transformando como as pessoas produzem conteúdo, se informam, se comunicam e se relacionam. A quantidade de informação circulando não tem precedentes. Nos deparamos com uma série de distorções, manipulações e questionamentos sobre a veracidade do que é divulgado. O mundo hiperconectado revela uma polifonia que pode gerar ruído. Mas a pluralidade de vozes é uma oportunidade. Por meio de uma comunicação transformadora, as organizações que buscam garantir e ampliar direitos podem dar mais espaço para vozes que antes não eram escutadas. Podem promover diálogos diversos, engajar e mobilizar para a construção de uma sociedade mais justa, democrática e sustentável. Uma comunicação estratégica pauta agendas, debates e impulsiona mudanças. Esse é o poder da comunicação, o poder da escuta, da reflexão, da troca, da ação. Em rede, buscamos fortalecer vozes que inspirem narrativas inclusivas, plurais e transformadoras. Narrativas por uma comunicação que mobiliza.
Olá, eu fui ao lado da Mari eleita para estar aqui representando o grupo que gestou essa rede. E antes de começar, então, eu acho que eu preciso agradecer muito a confiança que esse grupo depositou, um grupo 100% feminino, que muito me inspira e que vem trabalhando nisso há 1 ano e meio. A gente está brincando que a gente está hoje aqui parindo um filho. A todas as mulheres que já estiveram grávidas, imaginam o que é uma gestação de 1 ano e meio. Então, se solidarizem, por favor, com o nosso parto aqui, porque faz um tempo que a gente está olhando para isso. Bom, meu nome é Carolina Pasquale, eu sou diretora de comunicação do Alana, e eu fiquei pensando aqui o que eu ia falar hoje para vocês. Eu acho que eu não posso começar sem dizer que eu sou privilegiada por trabalhar numa organização que respira a comunicação. O Alana investe em comunicação, aposta, arrisca, se posiciona, às vezes quebra a cara, porque faz parte, mas esse é, sim, um privilégio. Outro privilégio é que a gente tem espaço ali, tanto eu quanto a minha equipe, para aprender, para buscar inspiração fora, para viajar, se for o caso, para entender o que está sendo feito de mais legal no mundo. E, nesse processo, foi ficando cada vez mais claro para mim que a gente precisava criar um espaço assim no Brasil, que estava faltando um lugar onde a gente pudesse encontrar os cases de sucesso e, por que não, os que não deram tão certo assim, que a gente pudesse encontrar dados, estatísticas, inspiração, o que funciona, o que não funciona. E essa sensação, essa vontade, nasceu de maneira muito semelhante nessas mulheres que compõem esse grupo aí, que há 1 ano e meio começou a trazer esse assunto à tona. Por que a gente não tem algo assim no Brasil? Por que a gente não traz algo muito semelhante? Por que a gente não está olhando para fortalecer esse setor, né, da comunicação para uma causa, para uma transformação? É nesse lugar que nascem narrativas, né? As ações que a gente está propondo fazer são disseminar conhecimento, mapear o setor, gerar conexão, e, quem sabe, ter uma rede tão forte, tão bacana, para que a gente possa promover campanhas e ações em conjunto. A gente sabe que tem questões aí socioambientais muito importantes para a gente lidar num futuro próximo, e a gente acha que fazer isso junto vai ser sempre mais efetivo do que cada um fazer por si. Então, são esses aí os nossos objetivos, vai, vamos dizer assim, mas a gente sabe também que esse aqui é só o começo. Estava conversando agora, antes de entrar ali com as... aliás, a gente tem um case incrível para subir na Narrativas, que é o case do Imagina na Copa e do Imagina VC. E eu estava conversando com elas, e elas me falaram, é uma rede? Eu falei, não, não é uma rede, vai ser uma rede se vocês entrarem nela, né? Hoje, no momento, é uma rede. Mas o que a gente quer muito é que vocês estejam com a gente nessa construção e que a gente tenha um lugar mesmo para contar o que, que a gente vem produzindo, esse setor vem produzindo no Brasil, e para a gente se posicionar. Eu acho que a gente está num momento de uma comunicação muito aguerrida. Eu acho que a gente está precisando falar, a gente está precisando compartilhar valores, a gente está precisando inspirar e se posicionar. Acho que o silêncio e a ausência vêm sendo notados, né? E eles são ocupados. Não se enganem, se a gente não ocupa, alguém ocupa. Então, o convite aí é para que a Narrativas e esse bloco do Congresso GIF de comunicação na programação aberta nos ajude a construir a comunicação nesse lugar estratégico, nos ajude a enfrentar o que está vindo aí pela frente enquanto setor, nos fortaleça também, né, para que a gente, de fato, deixe muito para trás a comunicação das organizações que pensa, sei lá, o relatório anual da organização, né? O relatório anual tem que, chefe, a gente faz relatório anual, não fica nervoso. Mas está longe de ser o que a gente precisa fazer como grande prioridade da vida, porque, enfim, contar o que a gente faz e prestar contas, obviamente, é importante, mas a gente está num momento que a gente precisa iluminar aquilo que a gente busca, né? Quais são as nossas causas, o que nos move, por que a gente levanta cedo todo dia para trabalhar. Então, um pouco é isso que a gente veio fazer aqui hoje. E aí eu fiquei também incumbida de apresentar os nossos palestrantes. Vale dizer que essa fala vai ser em inglês e que tem fones de tradução simultânea lá fora. Depois, às 18h30, a gente tem um segundo bloco com 3 mesas simultâneas que vocês têm na programação. Convido vocês a ficarem, aí também a gente consegue conversar melhor. E agora a gente vai ter a oportunidade de receber e ouvir aqui uma conversa mediada pela Luana Lobo. A Luana é sócia diretora da Flow, que é uma distribuidora de impacto cultural, e da produtora Maria Farinha Filmes, ambas parte do Grupo Alana. A Maria Farinha dá voz, ilumina e compartilha causas urgentes de histórias inspiradoras. E a Flow cria estratégias para expandir e engajar as pessoas. A distribuidora e a produtora são responsáveis por sucessos como O Começo da Vida, Nunca Me Sonharam e outros filmes que vocês devem ter ouvido falar. Ou assistido, tomara. E a Luana vai mediar essa conversa com o Gabriel Brocking, que está aqui, que é conselheiro-geral e vice-presidente executivo de negócios da Participant Media. Ele é responsável pela supervisão e investimentos dos filmes e conteúdos digitais e de televisão, e também desempenha um papel fundamental na formação e implementação de iniciativas estratégicas de negócios, além de gerenciar a equipe de negócios e assuntos jurídicos, conduzindo negociações para todas as atividades de conteúdo, marketing, distribuição e impacto social da empresa. Vale dizer, e vocês vão ver isso daqui a pouco, que a Participant Media já teve 52 indicações ao Oscar, já levou 12 para casa, e hoje é a principal empresa internacional de mídia dedicada ao entretenimento que inspira e promove mudanças sociais. Então, Luana e Gabriel, bem-vindos.
Obrigada, Carol, Mari, obrigada, GIF. E estou muito emocionada de ver esse lançamento do Narrativas aqui hoje. É fundamental para a gente fortalecer nossa comunicação em rede. Então, é um passo muito, muito bonito de ver acontecendo no Brasil, como sempre, de forma super pioneira. Gabriel, que honra ter você aqui com a gente hoje. E é muito especial para a gente ter você aqui nesse momento, porque a gente vem conversando há tantos anos, a gente compartilha há tantos anos essas experiências, os desafios e as insistências em apostar numa comunicação que transforma, apostar na potência que é você conectar entretenimento com transformação social, né? Afinal, a cultura é parte central do desenvolvimento sustentável. Vamos começar a apresentação. Então, acho que é esse aqui, né, Ju? Vamos começar aqui. A gente começou a conversar, a gente estava conversando aqui hoje mais cedo, lá no Alana, a gente gosta muito de exemplos como esse, que é uma revista de 1930, em que apresentava já esse sonho de um futuro tecnológico, né? Onde um dia duas pessoas poderiam se comunicar através de uma tela, mesmo estando em lugares diferentes. E, do ponto de vista de comunicação, é interessante pensar sobre o caminho estratégico entre uma ideia abstrata e a construção da realidade, né? Ou seja, a gente olhando para isso hoje, dá para ver o quanto uma comunicação bem feita pode realmente influenciar na nossa realidade. E aí que vem o pensamento para a gente que trabalha com cinema, que trabalha com audiovisual, como é que o grande comunicador de massas, que é o cinema, que é o audiovisual, especialmente o cinema hollywoodiano, vem contribuindo para esse imaginário coletivo de futuro, né? Como é que as novas gerações estão conseguindo visualizar esse futuro que a gente tanto aqui acredita, batalha todos os dias e sonha junto, né? E aí, infelizmente, a maioria deles, não todos, né? Mas a maioria deles ainda constrói esse futuro distópico, contrário, e vem batalhando para isso. E é importante a gente ter noção da dimensão disso, né? Então, olha o tanto de investimento que é feito em filmes como esse, né? Que estão construindo e colaborando para esse futuro, esse imaginário distópico. E a gente analisando isso, a gente ficou pensando como é que todo mundo que batalha por um futuro melhor é possível, acredita nisso aqui, pode lidar com essa força contrária, né? E daí que nasce a urgência e o nosso desejo em comum de reconstruir essa cultura de sonhar junto, de realmente a gente se unir para voltar a ver, sonhar, agir juntos e reconstruir esse imaginário coletivo de futuro. A Participant Media vem reconstruindo esse cenário nos Estados Unidos há muitos anos, então é uma grande inspiração para a gente. E vai ser incrível se você puder dividir com a gente um pouco como que, da onde veio essa visão de lutar por isso num ambiente tão hostil também para isso, que é Hollywood, né? E como é que foram as estratégias que vocês desenvolveram nos últimos anos, então, ao longo dessa trajetória, para colocar isso em prática, Gabriel?
Sim, com certeza. Obrigado primeiro por o convite. Eu vou falar português só agora no começo. Mas
o português dele é melhor do que o meu, gente. Desculpa, eu que ele fala.
Vou falar em inglês, mas eu tenho português limitado. Mas obrigado, muito obrigado a Luana, a Gif, por o convite aqui. Então, so, a Participant Media was founded 14 years ago now by Jeff Skoll. And Jeff Skoll was, he made his money initially as one of the first founders of eBay. And after he made his money doing that, he decided he wanted to dedicate himself to, you know, trying to make the world a better place. And when he was young, he had always been inspired by classic films like Gandhi and Schindler's List. So he had this vision of a media company that was dedicated exclusively to those types of films. So he, you know, his vision is one that I think we all share, which is a world of peace and prosperity and sustainability. And he believes that stories have a unique power and ability to bring that about. They can inspire people in a way that is unique to storytelling as a medium and has a power to change hearts and minds. And it's an important tool in the arsenal of social change. So he wanted to make a company that was just doing that, and the way he calls it is the most important media company in the world. That was his vision. At this point, we've, I think, been around, done a lot of content. We've made over 80 films, and as they've said, we've had a lot of commercial and critical success. You know, over $2 billion in worldwide box office combined for the movies, and a lot of Oscars, as was mentioned, which, you know, is a nice thing to have, but it's an important thing to have from an impact perspective because it raises and elevates the profile of the movies and the story that we're telling. So, of course, we're working with filmmakers who want awards, but no one is doing it for the awards. But the awards are an important part of that platform and that visibility. So, you know, at Participant, I do want to be clear, we're first and foremost storytellers. We're not really an activist organization. We're not on the front lines of social change. We're telling stories. So that's what everything starts with, is a compelling and entertaining story. If you don't have that, then no one's going to really want to see the content that you're producing, and then you won't have the opportunity to go out and use that as a tool to drive change on the issues that you care about.
So everything starts from that perspective. And then we work with, you know, everyone like you here in the room. We partner with them using the content we create as a tool to help catalyze and accelerate the change on the issues that you're already working on, that you may be on the front lines about, that you understand much more than we do, and that you can connect into and use our content as an asset to advance the work you're doing. That's very much the approach we take. We realize that we're not the people who are responsible for bringing about the change, but we view ourselves as an important contributor to catalyze that change. So yeah, as a bit of an introduction, I want to show a little video that will give you an idea of the work that we've done and how we go about doing it. And as you view this video, I think you'll see the theme that comes through in it. The approach we take to the work we do is we're looking really first and foremost to inspire people to take action, right? They should see our content because they want to see it, because it's an entertaining piece of content, and it should inspire them to want to do something. And then the second step is we then find the way to partner with organizations or build the tools to empower them to go and do something about it, right? So inspire them, then empower them, and then the third kind of fundamental piece of what we do is we need to connect them to each other. So like-minded individuals who want to make change, who are now empowered to take action because we've created the tools or connected them into the organizations that are actually enabling them to take action. We want to connect them all together. So we work with various organizations who oftentimes, you know, are working on the same issue but are not working together. A lot of times they're working independently on the same issue, and a movie or a piece of content can be a tool to bring them together around that.
E é muito heartwarming ver um vídeo como esse, para a gente ver que existe sim uma força contribuindo para esse futuro melhor e possível. E é isso que consegue engajar as pessoas. É assim que a gente vai conseguir mobilizar e trazê-las para parte da solução. A solução já está aí, ela já está acontecendo, e a gente precisa comunicar mais ela, porque o contrário disso vem sendo feito também com bastante competência e bastante investimento, né? No Alana, também, de forma muito pioneira, 10 anos atrás, o Alana começou a investir no audiovisual, arriscar como ferramenta de transformação. E eu fico muito, muito feliz de ter aqui comigo meus sócios na Maria Farinha e na Flow, Marcos Nishi, Ana Lúcia Vilela, Estela Renner, que compartilham dessa visão comigo. E foi muito, foi um privilégio para mim, quando voltei para o Brasil, encontrá-los que com essa visão comum, né? E na hora que a gente começa a pensar nisso, a gente parece um bando de maluco achando que é possível. E foi muito gratificante eu conseguir dividir com eles que a Participant Media já vinha fazendo isso no Brasil, isso nos Estados Unidos, uma trajetória também com esse mesmo sonho comum. E isso foi super incentivador para a gente. E assim a gente começou essa relação há muitos anos. E conversando aqui também com os desafios do GIF, Gabriel, a gente entende as organizações como isso que você falou, né? Elas estão no front line, eles estão de fato são os change makers, e uma fonte única de conhecimento, uma fonte única de dados de pesquisa, de informação super relevante para a sociedade. E aí fica sempre o desafio de como é a melhor forma de conectar todas essas informações e mobilizar as pessoas em volta desses assuntos, né? Tem esse gap, esse desafio de trazer essas mensagens para um formato que mobilize as pessoas. Então, conta para a gente um pouquinho desse caminho que vocês fazem entre escolher um assunto para ser falado, escolher o melhor formato e como mobilizar a audiência para a gente nos últimos 10 anos que vocês vêm fazendo isso.
Yes, of course. So, we work, like I said, and as Alana said, in a lot of different formats. And you have to think through, when we're getting into it, what format we're choosing, depending on the story we're trying to tell and the audience we're trying to reach. So you have to really think about that and tailor the stories and the format for those things. So here on the screen now, you'll see kind of an example of this is the annual volume of content that we produce. And I should mention that we generally develop, produce, and finance the content. We're not the distributors directly. So Participant really is sort of behind the scenes, coming up with ideas, working with the creative community to create the content, and we finance it, but we're not you know, kind of front line on the distribution side. We work with distribution partners to get it out into the world. And the reason we do that as well is also for the same reason that we choose different formats is different distributors are sometimes better suited for different pieces of content. And so we want to be able to choose which distributor we work with if, depending on how they spark to the content. So they have to show us that they're very interested in it, that, that they're engaged in it, and that they have they're reaching the audience we want to reach. So that is actually part of the reason that we work with a variety of different distribution partners. But so narrative film, which is scripted kind of fiction film, is where we started 14 years ago. The company really started with film, both narrative and documentary, but that's the core of our business. So we make about 5 to 6 of those per year. And you know, film has real advantages when it comes to trying to move on issues, right? It's a very high profile event release, right? So it can bring a lot of people together around the same time around a single event where you have a lot of money going into a big marketing campaign already that you can take advantage of. And so you're able to sort of have this spark that can really be a moment in time to push an issue into the zeitgeist or to sort of create a tipping point on that issue because you create so much conversation at one point in time. So really that's why film was where Jeff started. It's what he saw as the most visible examples of the content that inspired him. One thing I should mention as we think about how we work though, our research has shown us really that a steady drumbeat of content is also very important when you want to make change on an issue. So it's not just one big event where you bring attention to the issue at that moment, create a big conversation, and engage people to take action. It's actually coming back to it again and again and again through different stories and different formats. So that is also why we work across all media, and we do tell stories about climate change, for example, but we'll do it with a film, we'll do it with a fiction film, with a documentary film, maybe with a TV series, and with short form content on digital and even VR now, right? So we try to go into all kinds of different formats and repeatedly come back to it because our research has shown consistently that it takes several times of people viewing an idea or a message for it to really internalize and sink into them. So on scripted films, these are some examples of the movies that we've produced over the years, and in the video you saw, all those movies in that video were movies that participant was involved in producing and financing. Other reasons that film is a particularly useful format when you're thinking about social change and driving change with that content is it's a communal viewing experience, right? So you get together in theaters, if it works well, and a lot of people go to theaters, you get together and you watch it in a communal experience. And that has a different effect than watching something alone in your house in front of a TV screen or on your smartphone when you're, you know, driving on a train or on a bus. So there's a unique power there, and it's also, it lives on, it has a very long legacy. There's a lot of what's called downstream windows in film. So it'll start in theaters, then it'll, you know, go to home video and DVD and digital rental. Then it'll go to SVOD, the streaming kind of like Netflix services. Then it goes to the free TV services. So films will live on for many, many years and play across all these windows, which is, you know, it's great from a impact perspective because it'll be out there for a long time and people will have a chance to see it for many years to come. And it's also an important part of the economic model for us because each of those windows creates a different revenue opportunity to build a sustainable business that we can then continue, you know, to reinvest and create more content. So when it comes to narrative films, there are some real challenges as well that you have to keep in mind on that format in particular. They're very expensive to make, is one of the first and foremost. So that's a big barrier to entry for many people. So, you know, that's why Jeff also decided to start there, because that's the most visible, the highest profile, but also one of the hardest to do. He was in a privileged position to be able to do it, and he wanted to reach as many people as possible. Another thing to keep in mind with film is it's a very long development process. For anyone who's worked in film, they will know it's many, many years before, from an idea to where you hire a writer, you get a script, you develop that script, you go out and find a director who's interested in directing, you go and find the actors and you wait for the window when they're available to be in your movie, and then you produce the movie, and then, you know, a long period of post-production, and then finding the right window to release the movie. So you're talking at least usually 3 years in the best case And so you have to really think ahead on what are the issues that you want to deal with. It's very difficult to time it perfectly. So you do have to kind of be a little bit of where is it that things are going, where are they moving towards, and try to predict that. Scripted film in particular, which is the fiction film, is our tool for reaching a mass audience, right? So it's the most broad and commercial product we have. It's where we try to make it as entertaining as possible, as commercial as possible, because we're trying to reach beyond the people who we speak to on a day-to-day basis, right? In English, we say, there's a lot of time that we're preaching to the choir. That's a saying where, I don't know how it translates in Portuguese, but you're already, you know, talking to people who believe in your cause and have already converted to the cause. With narrative scripted film, you're reaching people that aren't necessarily thinking about that issue. They're not necessarily thinking about a particular cause. They're going because it looks like an interesting and entertaining movie. And a participant, we say we are hiding the spinach in the popcorn. So
it's so maravilhoso.
Yeah, we're escondendo espinafre na pipoca. Espinafre está escondida na pipoca. You have to think about including the message in a way that's not front and center. Examples of that. A recent example that was very successful, particularly here in Brazil as well, but worldwide, was Wonder, which was translated to Extraordinario here in Brazil. It was a film we had this year that was, you know, very much that, a film that reached a very broad and wide audience because it wasn't, although it was definitely about an important issue, about being kind to each other and about themes of social inclusion and the importance of and celebrating people's differences rather than kind of, you know, alienating people because of them. So I think we are going to show the trailer of that now.
My name is Augie Pullman. Next week, I start fifth grade. And since I've never been to real school before, I'm pretty much totally petrified.
I'll see you later.
Okay. You don't want to walk up with your parents because it's not cool.
But you're cool.
I know I am, but technically most dads aren't. Neither are these helmets.
Dear God, please make them be nice to me.
I know I'm not an ordinary 10-year-old kid. I've had 27 surgeries. They've helped me to breathe, to see, to hear without a hearing aid, but none of them have made me look ordinary.
The incubator, Bunsen burners. Oh, and this is an eraser.
You know what an eraser is, right?
Look at his face. I've never seen anything that ugly in my life.
If I looked like him, I'd swear I'd put a hood over my face.
I know you don't always like it, but I love it. It's my son's face.
You are not ugly, Augie.
You just have to say that because you're my mom.
Because I'm your mom, it counts the most, because I know you the most.
Hi, you don't have to do this.
I don't know what you're talking about, Augie.
You don't have to pretend is all I'm saying.
Augie!
Okay, I'm really sorry. Why are you sitting here then?
Because I want some nice friends for a change.
Me too.
Who is it that I aspire to be? That is the question that we should be asking ourselves all the time.
Hey, Jack, come sit here.
In a sec. Like to be able to control the weather.
That would be your superpower? That sounds pretty lame.
What would you do?
I'd be invisible.
You're the toughest kid in that school. Show them.
You can't blend in when you were born to stand out.
You ever thought about having plastic surgery?
Dude, this is after plastic surgery. It takes a lot of work to look this good.
Thank you. And I should have mentioned ahead of time, we're going to have a lot of videos since we are a media company. It's part of the presentation. So that's a good example of, like I said, the fiction film when in the best successful case, right? Where we made a movie that reached a huge global audience. I think it's made over $250 million worldwide. So we made a lot of money doing it, and we had a huge reach with it. And that's really important because one other part that, and this is a part that I'm much very close to because I run the business side as well, is you need those home run wins in order to sustain the entire portfolio, right? From a business perspective, film is very much like venture capital investment. It's a portfolio approach where you have to invest consistently across many films, hoping for the ones that are going to hit and really have an outsized financial return that will then allow us to keep investing and producing the content that we're making. So that's very much part of the financial approach, and that is a part of the company. We're a double bottom line company, is what we call it, so we're focused both on profit and impact, and they're both equal, maybe with impact being a little more important. And the reason that profit is relevant is really only to prove that you can be a successful business by doing things that are good for the world, right? That's part of Jeff's vision for the world, and what he set out to do here is create a company that's going to show Hollywood that this type of content is viable, is sustainable, that you can make money doing this, and that they should be investing and distributing these movies as well. So it's a part of our mission insofar as it advances the impact cause as well. So kind of turning to the other type of films that we produce are documentaries. Those are also kind of feature length. They're usually at least 90 minutes to 2 hours long. They're usually, you know, more directly related to the issues that we're dealing with. So it's much more kind of front and center. It's usually more serious content. Doesn't have to be, but does often tend to be. Here are examples of a lot of the documentaries we've produced over the years. They tend to speak to not quite as broad of an audience. You are speaking more to people who already are thinking about that issue. You're hoping to expand a little bit and reach people who maybe want to know more about it, who've heard about it or thought about it, but you're trying to get them engaged. And if you get somebody to go watch the full film, they'll come out of that really being much more aware of the issues. And, you know, that's one of the big goals, is to elevate the awareness and then hopefully inspire them. You know, at the same time, these films, they're a lot cheaper to make. They cost a lot less, but they still take just as long, if not longer, sometimes. And they just don't reach the same wide audience. Now, that is starting to change a little bit with the advances that are going on in sort of the distribution side of the media industry. You know, companies like Netflix, like Amazon, now Facebook, Apple. They're all getting into content distribution, original content distribution, and, you know, long form like film as well, and they are, you know, truly global companies with global reach, and this content for them is actually over-indexing in terms of how it performs, meaning that their customers, their viewers, are watching documentaries much more than people expected on those platforms. So companies like Netflix are investing very heavily in documentary film. They're buying a lot. They're making a lot of their own. Which has created a real, you know, kind of new age of opportunity for documentary filmmakers. There are actually more buyers than there ever have been, and you have a wider reach than you've ever been able to have before. So that's a really a compelling opportunity for us. We're excited about that as we look forward. I'm going to show an example of the trailer from one of our documentary films, Malala, which was is based on the story and the life of Malala Yousafzai, who is a Nobel Peace Prize winner from Pakistan, who you know, risked her own life basically to really promote and advance the cause of girls' education.
There's a moment when you have to choose whether to be silent or to stand up.
Tonight, Malala remains in intensive care.
She was shot in the head for daring to suggest girls should go to school.
Me and my wife, we cried all the night.
The doctors told me she will survive, but she may not be the same as she was.
They shot me on the left side of my head. They thought that the bullet would silence us. I am the same Malala.
I'm still 17. I'm still a teenager.
She's a little bit naughty, a little bit that much.
Who would you have been if you were just an ordinary girl from the Swat Valley?
I'm still an ordinary girl, but if I had an ordinary father and an ordinary mother, then I would have two children now.
This is my youngest brother. He's a really good boy. This is the laziest one. My father said, "Have you forgiven them?"
You've never felt angry?
No. I want people to learn from the experience I had.
Very nice to see you.
I know, nice to see you.
A woman is more powerful than you.
In this new school, it's hard. Physics, 61%.
You think you could ever ask your boy out on a date?
Roger Federer.
You like him?
I like his haircut.
When I think of home, I miss the dirty streets. I miss the river. I miss my friends. I just want to see that house just
once. You named her after a girl who spoke out and was killed.
almost as if you said she'll be different.
You're right.
I am those 66 million girls who are deprived of education. I'm not a lone voice. I am many. And our voices are our most powerful weapons. One child, one teacher, one book, and one pen. They can change the world.
My father only gave me the name Malala. He didn't make me Malala. I chose this life, and now I must continue it.
Esse filme foi lançado aqui no Brasil bem no momento em que estava acontecendo todas aquelas manifestações dos estudantes. Então, eu assisti e falei, meu Deus, eu queria levar isso para todos os estudantes, todas as escolas, todo mundo precisava ver e compartilhar essa inspiração, né? E acaba que tem sim, super desafios nesse caminho, mas que realmente essas histórias precisam realmente chegar muito mais longe, porque são incríveis.
Obrigado, Nancy. On that film, we had the really good fortune, too, to be partnered with a worldwide distribution partner with Fox and National Geographic as well. We had both companies together. Fox did the theaters and the home video, and National Geographic did TV. So we were able to have a single distributor around the world and had a really extraordinary reach for a documentary film. It's very difficult to get really wide distribution for a film like that. But at the same time, it's an extremely inspirational story. It's very important that as many people as possible see this movie. And the distributors, Fox and National Geographic, realize that when we show it to their, you know, they are human beings that are sitting there behind those companies, and they get inspired by this idea of trying to do something. And that's a big part of our mission, too, as participant and everybody, is to inspire other companies working in the space to see the power and the opportunity in it. And to try to develop this part of the business, right, that's telling these positive stories is both rewarding because you can make real change, and it can be a real financial opportunity for them as well. So with this film like Malala, we did partner with a lot of, primarily Malala's already existing foundation to advance her cause and use the film as a tool for that. So it was used for fundraising for the initiatives that they were already working on, but very specific initiatives that we helped her create that we could push to where people who saw the film could go and donate. But it would go to specific schools that she was building in Afghanistan or in Kenya or in different parts around the developing world, so that the audience could feel like it was a direct sort of link. It wasn't just donating to a general fund that was going to advance the work. It was a very specific thing, and it tied into the story in the movie, actually, like a lot of the campaign of what that money was going towards. A very successful film for us, a great example of what we hope to achieve with our documentaries. I think maybe we'll move on a little bit to some television examples of TV content. This is a relatively newer area for us at Participant. We're just getting back into producing both scripted and documentary style episodic content, so television series. I call it episodic now because TV is changing a lot. It's hard to define what TV is anymore. Is Netflix television? I think yes. Some people will say no. But we're kind of producing across all these formats. So the one that's on the screen now is called America to Me. It's by a filmmaker named Steve James who has made a lot of documentary films and came to us wanting to work on something that he didn't know if it was going to be a film or a series. He thought, this is a longer story, it's a more complex and a nuanced story that I want to be able to tell. And so we gave him the flexibility to figure it out, like to start developing the idea, get in there, and then think through, is this best suited as a feature film format, so a two-hour film, or is it better as a series of over 10 hours, 10 episodes? And as it was going, it grew from a two-hour film, then became a four-part miniseries, then became a six-part miniseries, then became a 10-part series in the end. So we gave him a lot of creative flexibility, and it turned out it's a great series. So it speaks to one of the unique, I think, aspects of the episode format television, is that you can tell stories over a much longer period of time. You can go into much more detail and nuance on issues that are complicated, and you can explore kind of over time with viewers, because they'll come back to it. It's not a one-time thing. And you can do it over multiple seasons as well. If it works, you can keep going season after season, and you can bring in different storylines in the second season or in the third season that start to pick up different issues. So that's a really, you know, powerful medium and format as well. So it, as you think about the story you want to tell, that's a very important thing of what, you know, is this better as a movie because it will have a big impact one time, that's the type of story, or should we look at it as a series and what's the opportunity there? As you think about TV, other advantages of it are that it does generally have less financial risk than film does. It's not as much kind of banking on whether people are going to go to the theater to see it, because you work with the TV networks well ahead of time as you're developing the content, and you sell it to them kind of ahead of time, and they provide a lot of financial backing as you go. You know, some of the challenges, or not even challenge, but some of the differences from film are it's less likely to create that sort of big event, water cooler moment where you get a lot of attention on an issue at the same time, although that is also changing with the way that company TV has evolved. Now TV is becoming this sort of must-see thing where people are talking about it at the office the next day, or when Netflix puts a new series up and all the episodes are available at the same time. It can make it a real conversation starter in the public dialogue. So I think we have an example
tem uma,
here.
Tem uma coisa interessante de TV, né? Que eu lembro que estava assistindo Breaking Bad. E aí é isso que você falou, né? O tempo de engagement que você tem num assunto é muito maior. Então eu fiquei pensando, imagina se a gente tivesse, se eu tivesse passado esses meus 2 meses pensando em direitos humanos, né? Mas eu estava pensando em tráfico de drogas. Mas realmente é um potencial de engajamento, de conversa sobre um assunto com a audiência diferente do que uma vez, né, assistindo um filme ou em short films, né?
Exactly. I think for impact it's a different type of power, but it's very powerful to be able to come back to it multiple times and get audiences that follow that storyline for multiple seasons. Yeah, I mean it's an amazing thing. So we're now very focused. That's one of the biggest areas of growth for us as we think about our future is both scripted and documentary type television. The one that we're going to show an example of is a documentary series where this filmmaker went into a public high school in Chicago and followed students over the course of an entire school year with 6 different film crews. Following the students both in the classroom and at home. And what he was exploring was, in the US, we've been working in, you know, in Brazil, I know it's a huge issue as well, kind of public education. But in the US, we've been trying to figure out how to continually close the gap that exists in achievement between sort of high income and low income families. And it also tends to break down along race lines as well in terms of white versus African American or Latino families. There's this persistent gap in educational achievement, that even when the students from underprivileged backgrounds are given access to the same level of education, they're all going to the same high school. This is a high school that is one of the most multicultural high schools in the country. And they're all getting a very top-notch, the best-in-class public education available in the US, but that gap between these students is not closing. And so that it shows that giving everybody a great education is not enough in and of itself. And so this filmmaker wanted to explore that issue. And that's a complicated issue. You have to go into the home with the students in order to even try to understand what's going on outside of school that's causing this performance gap to persist. So that's what this series is about. And he did it over, like I said, 10 hours and really needing to follow these students at home and in school over the course of an entire year to start really getting to the depth that you need to crack such a complex issue.
Esse não foi lançado ainda, né?
Has not premiered yet.
Está
assistindo
antes de todo mundo.
This is a special preview, so please do not film, though. It will be launched in this summer in the U.S. and it will also be sold worldwide as well. So, as you can see, that is a very complicated story to tell, right? That you can get a sense from watching that why it needs to be kind of over a longer period of time, 10 episodes. And that it actually deals with a lot of different issues in the same series. Issues of education, issues of inequality, issues of race. And in success, we hope that can actually go, we can do another season of it where we go to a different school and maybe we explore different issues that are unique to that community and do a full season there. But one of the interesting things when you think about the impact of a series like that, just the making of the series is actually part of the impact on something like this. Because when the filmmaker approached the school wanting to get access to be able to tell this story, There was a lot of disagreement internally at the school about whether to let him in and whether to tell the story, because it's very easy to see how, if you're the principal of a school, that could go really badly for you, right? All of a sudden, the filmmaker's coming in and telling a story that's going to make you look very bad, like you're not doing something well. At the same time, I think there were people in the school board and at a higher level that understood the opportunity that this presented for them, that they had a problem that they were struggling with, even with the best of intentions, putting a lot of resource into trying to solve the problem. They weren't figuring it out. They didn't know how to do it. So they decided to, you know, authorize the documentary as a method of self-reflection and introspection, trying to diagnose the problem, bringing a third-party perspective in to really help them figure it out. And so that kind of progressive thinking, I think, is really inspiring to see on behalf of the school. But also, it's going to be a powerful tool for change for them when they're serious about solving this problem at the school. This is a huge opportunity for them, and we hope them that by telling this story and showing this to the rest of the world, it can inspire other schools and other districts to think about these issues and approach it similarly. Next, I wanted to just talk a little bit about short form content, which is kind of the other format that we've been doing a lot of work in. Now we do about 40 hours a year of short form content. That equals one original video per day. And short form has a lot of advantages of being able to produce it much, much, much more quickly and at much lower cost. So you can be very timely with this type of content. It responds much more to what's going on into the world in current events or in the news in real time. We can produce videos as quickly as, you know, in one day. So it's a powerful tool in the arsenal of the content we produce for that reason alone. But it also reaches different audiences that are, you know, tend to be the younger audiences who are not watching films and TV with the same kind of levels that they were before. The consumption for younger audiences is moving heavily into short-form digital content, and that's a huge opportunity because, like never before, we now have a reach into directly to all these young people. They're watching it on their phone at any moment during the day, and you have these platforms that have developed the technology where, through a single free platform, we can reach, you know, a very global audience. Facebook being a great example, YouTube being a great example. The power of that and the power to engage with your audience via digital is also revolutionary from kind of an impact perspective, because you get data that is not available to you otherwise. You can build communities, especially on something like Facebook, where you can keep them engaged. You can come back to them with other content that is similar that you think might be interesting to them later. And you can kind of have a meaningful dialogue and conversation with your viewers in a way that isn't really as possible with film and TV. So as you think about kind of the use of content and how you communicate, short form, I think, has to be part of anybody's strategy as you think about it, because it's an extent, it's a way to reach audiences you're not going to otherwise reach, but it also serves as an extension of the longer form content that we make. So we think of short form in both ways, as original, you know, standalone content to try to move an issue. But we also have different parts of our short form strategy that ties into our longer form content, where we can expand the reach of our campaign and that content by creating a lot of short form, shorter videos that either specifically target sort of sub audiences that we want to reach within that. So, you know, there's examples of a film that we made, an Inconvenient sequel, which was the follow-up to Inconvenient Truth, A Verdade Inconveniente. Well, the sequel was all about solutions to the problem and how they exist, how this technology exists. And we knew that the film wasn't going to ever reach the same level of success that the original film did. I mean, there's a reason that nobody makes sequels to documentaries usually. I think it's one of the only times anyone's made a sequel to a documentary film. But we saw it as an opportunity to bring the solutions, and really the short-form content strategy around it was a big part of our campaign itself. The trailer for that movie reached, I think, 60 million views on Facebook, something like that. It was an astonishing number for a trailer for a documentary film. And we designed the trailer itself to be a call to action for people. So the trailer was actually part of our message and our campaign. So you could watch that trailer and you could get a sense of the impact and the campaign and the content. And you never really have to see the full film because we knew that a lot of people would never see the full film, but it did also increase the number of people that would want to see the film. But even if they don't, we reached them with that trailer and we reached them with the other short form content that connected into our impact opportunities. So we worked with a lot of NGOs and it all connected in that short form content side. So it's a really powerful tool there, in addition to kind of a standalone thing.
É super interessante isso, né, de pensar, a gente sempre aprende, volta para a pergunta de para quem, como, o que, que a gente quer comunicar e para que audiência a gente vai falar, né, porque isso faz total diferença. E a gente teve essa experiência também com o Começo da Vida, que a gente estava conversando mais cedo, de a gente teve um experimento de expandir o conteúdo, foram 400 horas de conteúdo, né, então a gente fez o documentário de 90 minutos, mas também desdobramos numa série que também está no Netflix Global, de 6 episódios e mais 80 pílulas de 3 minutos que a gente soltou na internet e já impactaram mais de 5 milhões de pessoas. Então, é super interessante ver como cada conteúdo, cada formato alcança um número diferente de audiência, né? E traz também, potencializa a mensagem. Mas é legal também perceber que um trailer sozinho também ele não teria feito tanto esse impacto, porque não tem o filme longo que dá base para tudo que a gente está falando, que mostra a importância de todo o assunto, né? Então, ele dá a big picture, mas também tem os mais rápidos, que você tem que ter menos engagement de tempo, né? Mas você também é impactado pela mensagem e depois procura saber mais sobre aquele assunto. Então, toda essa estratégia de pensar em múltiplos formatos é super importante para o impacto de uma causa, né?
Yeah, but it's part of that drumbeat of content, hitting the same issue with from different sides and in different places multiple times. I mean, it's a key part of our strategy whenever we make a big investment in a long-form content like a film, to make a lot of short-form as well, because it will amplify the impact significantly. And I think relevant also for kind of the organizations that are in the room, the short-form content also provides us an opportunity to more directly connect our content to the work that the organizations are doing, because the film itself is going to be about the story it's telling. The short form content, we have a lot more flexibility to tie it into the film, to the story that this organization or this other organization or the impact that they're having, or the story that, you know, the kind of the opportunity to take impact by joining their cause. So it's a tool to extend the network as well and tie the organizations into the big movement of An Inconvenient Truth, for example, without, you know, having to mention everybody in the film, because if you make a film that's too much about the issue, you're going to fail. You need to make the movie as entertaining as possible. So this is a tool to sort of address and kind of cover it in a way that's very beneficial.
E vocês também estão experimentando fazer algumas coisas em VR, né?
Yes. Yeah, so the last area I wanted to touch on briefly is we've started experimenting in virtual reality. Actually, this is an example of a short form video first.
Hi, I'm Mr. Ballou, Coach Ballou.
My name is Mrs. Hall.
My name is Mr. Smith.
Soy Melissa Soto.
My name is Miss Coy.
You'd never turn it off. We become a family, and yeah, they are my kids.
I've been called a lot of things from the mouths of 10 and 11 and 12-year-olds.
I also tell them, sometimes you're in school longer than you're actually at home.
Yeah.
And I tell them the same thing. I spend more time with you than I spend with my own family.
When I get into this space where it's like they're my kids, and then if they make a mistake, which they will do, mm-hmm, I get doubtful, like, am I making a difference?
You have that those times where you kind of wonder, why am I exerting all this energy and this effort? And I did get that doubt sometimes.
I don't know any teacher in my life that made a difference in which I go, that was a great lesson. Mm-hmm. I think about the ones that made a difference to me as a person. And so when they mess up, the perfectionist in me takes it very personal.
Mm-hmm. Give me one second.
All right.
What? Are you kidding me?
Oh, snap. A to the J.
Dear Miss Coy,
I came into fifth grade as a shy girl who especially struggled with talking in front of people.
You took an interest in the things that were important to me, always asking about my family and showing interest in my love for baseball.
Because of your teaching, you have inspired me to do whatever my passion is when I grow up.
Winning at all costs, that's every coach's motto. What made you more unique was that you didn't care about the wins. You wanted us to be better individuals day by day.
I remember whenever I got stuck in a problem and I thought I just couldn't do it, you said, it's not that I couldn't do it, I just couldn't do it yet.
Tú eres mi favorito maestra, pero yo sé que hablas inglés.
Thank you for making the past year great, and I can't wait to spend the next 8 months with you.
Thanks for being the man and for being a great teacher. Your boy, A to the J.
A to the J.
Thank you for making me a better person, and thank you for never giving up on me and helping me become the man I am today. Love, Danny.
Hey, Coach.
What's up, Coach?
Coach.
We appreciate your dedication and effort you put towards us. We thank you for not just making us better basketball players, but better men.
This is for you.
Thank you, Coach.
My gosh, man.
It's good to see you.
Congratulations. Oh.
I'm so proud of you.
Family on three. One, two, three.
Family.
Here you go.
Ele veio me dar a notícia de que a gente tem 15 minutos para acabar e a gente nem mostrou a surpresa final para vocês ainda. Então, a gente vai ter que correr aqui um pouquinho para alcançar esse tempo.
Tá bom. That, very quickly, that's an example of the short form video we forgot to introduce, but that you can see how that can tie into content about education and be an extension of that and thanking teachers. And it can be done in a way that video is designed to really speak to younger audiences and students. Who are the ones that are consuming short-form video kind of uniquely to them and how to kind of advance sort of the issues that we're trying to do, kind of beyond just the long form. So, so we'll move on. We'll skip ahead. These are examples of some of the other media, VR, and live experiences that we're now experimenting in, which are much more immersive and kind of opportunities to create empathy and break down barriers. So virtual reality is one that we're very excited about. It's not yet very widespread, and live experiences as well, kind of our activations, like this example there is putting two strangers in a ball pit together and then having them ask each other questions, or having a phone booth on the street where you have two strangers give compliments to each other. Like these kinds of activations that can be done on the street in public, or that can be done in a conference kind of in the lobby area. They're very unique because they can kind of shift people's attitudes in a different way. So it is part of how we think about content as well.
A gente vai passar para uma parte que é super interessante, só para dar um exemplo de impacto também. Quando a gente começou a trabalhar para a TV aberta e pensar em como é que a gente traduz essas narrativas para uma audiência maior, a gente começou em 2013 a criar formatos com a TV, a gente fez os Jovens Inventores. E quando a gente recebeu esse gráfico, a gente foi muito feliz de ver que, em 2014, quando a gente começou a fazer essa série, que tinha o desafio de ter uma linguagem para a TV aberta e trazer a ciência como uma pauta para ficar mais pop para os jovens, a gente conseguiu, assim, ó, começou em 2014 a série, e aí, 2 anos depois, já tinha mais do que dobrado o interesse de jovens por feiras de ciências no Brasil. Então, esse tipo de resultado é super... É interessante para a gente ver o quanto, de fato, uma comunicação pode impactar na realidade, né? E aí a gente tem vários cases, eu vou pular, porque também a gente tem outros painéis que vão detalhar mais os cases do começo da vida, Nunca Me Sonharam, que é super interessante entender como é que foi um movimento super colaborativo, e a Carol e todos os outros parceiros vão dividir com vocês mais detalhes no próximo painel. Então, não vou dar spoiler e vou pular essa parte. Mas queria que, Gabe, você contasse um pouquinho para a gente dessa conexão entre, tudo bem, agora a gente já falou das narrativas, da escolha dos assuntos, dos formatos, mas como que se conecta com social change mesmo, né? Como que se conecta nas campanhas? Porque uma coisa, além do acesso, que é super importante, é a diversidade de narrativas. E o Mulher Fantástica, que foi lançado recentemente no Brasil, ganhou o Oscar esse ano, acho que é um exemplo lindo de diversidade, né? Trazendo a pauta da diversidade para o assunto. Então, se você puder dividir um pouquinho desses resultados de Impact Campaign para a gente, antes da gente contar a surpresa final, vai ser super legal. Eu vou pular o vídeo, porque vocês têm 10 minutos.
Here we have a few examples of just films that I'll talk to quickly on each of the campaigns, and they provide different examples of what we try to accomplish in each campaign. So, when we first start thinking about how we design a campaign, the first inspiration is definitely the content itself and the story that's being told. And then we go out and we do a sort of issue landscaping, we call it. And we do this while the content is in development as well, so that it informs our creative process to make sure that we are accurately reflecting the issues in the content. And that's where we start to plant the seeds for the partnerships that we're going to make with the different advocacy organizations or impact organizations that are experts on that particular issue. So with A Fantastic Woman, we worked with, Una Mujer Fantástica, we worked with various organizations that work on LGBT issues, transgender issues, in the United States primarily, but also in Chile, where the movie was being made. And with that film, we were at the very beginning of that issue's sort of visibility. We're not really necessarily so far down. Each issue has sort of a life cycle. And depending on where that issue is in the public consciousness, impacts how we go about designing the campaign, kind of what our goal of the campaign is. So with Una Mujer Fantástica, it was really just to raise awareness about the issue in the first place. It needed to get to that level of people learning about it and thinking about it. It's something that most people aren't thinking about. So it was very press and media kind of PR strategy of trying to get as much attention around the movie and the fact that this was a movie about a normal universal story for those that haven't seen it or that don't really know what it's about. It's about a transgender woman and her partner, and they go through a very universal experience that everybody in life goes through, where her partner dies. It's kind of a terrible, tragic accident that happens, and she loses a loved one, but then the experience that she has as a result of kind of the process that happens from that point forward, how she deals with his family, how she deals with the authorities, how she deals with going to the funeral or not, it's extremely different for her because she's transgender. That's the only reason. And it's something that you would never necessarily think about unless these issues affect you. But it's a very sort of universal story that's heartbreaking, and it opens your mind to realize this is wrong, and that this is something we should be thinking about. And there are laws right now that prevent her from, things like going and being kind of the relative that gets to access medical records, or even the rights she had to attend the funeral, or a lot of things, and how she was treated in the investigation, kind of the police were looking into because it was an accident. All of it is, you could see how it happens in real life, and it's terrible. So this was really about focusing on that kind of issue and raising awareness as the movie, as a tool for shining a spotlight on that issue. The way we did it was, we're lucky enough to have it be critically acclaimed. It was nominated for an Oscar. We went out and targeted all the press and media outlets. We made a big effort to get her, Daniela Vega, the star of the movie, who is a transgender actress, to be a presenter at the Oscars this last year. And that was the first time that a transgender person had ever presented at the Oscars. And that became a news story in and of itself. And that was part of our strategy to submit that idea, to push her forward as that. It was good timing where in Hollywood, people are looking at sort of inclusivity and inclusion and diversity of story of voices. So it was the perfect opportunity. And 40 million people saw that. We then had a bunch of press coverage. The filmmaking crew went down to Chile to meet with the president. So that's a good example there. Wonder, I talked about already a bit as well in terms of the campaign we did with the Cities of Kindness. I'm not sure how deep I went into it, but the idea there was the movie is about inspiring kindness. So there we partnered with schools around the country to inspire that city to become a city of kindness. So to have a program where they would track every act of kindness on a website. Every time somebody does something kind for another person, they go in, they log in, they track it. And the city needs to reach 1 million acts of kindness to be designated a city of kindness. And then the mayor would host a special screening of the movie. And you had everybody, kind of all the school kids, come together. And there was a lot of field trips organized for all the classrooms that were participating in that effort to go and watch the movie together and celebrate their acts of kindness. So it was a very nice kind of campaign that was designed with that sort of broad reach of just inspiring people to think about these issues. And then these other two, Food Inc. and An Inconvenient Sequel, were examples where issues were much further along, and they're much more substantive issues that we were dealing with. and the movies also were tailored to kind of deal with them in a more substantive way. So we had very concrete impact goals there, where we would partner with the different NGOs that we were working with. On Food Inc., for example, we had two primary goals in the campaign. One was to shift legislation on the issue, and there was a law that was before the Congress in the United States at the time called the Childhood Nutrition Act, which funded a lot of the nutritious school food into schools and raised awareness around what it is that you're eating and the type of food that's going into your body. So we really focused on a big legislative advocacy effort in Washington, D.C., and it was a key tool, you know, to screen for a lot of the congressmen, a lot of the people who influence the laws. And this movie was a very big asset. I mean, we screened it for all of, like, they had a joint session of Congress to screen the movie. I mean, it's a really amazing kind of opportunity when you get to screen it for these influencers. We also then were looking to shift individual behavior as well. So it was about educating and inspiring people and then giving them the tools to make the right choices, because there are organizations out there who are working on these tools and they exist, and we just needed to connect people, wake them up to the issues and then connect them to those tools so that they could make their informed decisions about the food they were putting into their body. With an inconvenient sequel, we had a couple different goals as well. And this is a good example of where you design an impact campaign. There are different phases of it. There's the pre-release phase, where there's actually a lot that you can do before the movie is ever released, before the mass audience sees the movie. And then we had kind of the release phase of our strategy, and then the post-release phase of our strategy. So on many of our campaigns, we do think about it kind of in those three areas. And so before the movie is released, you can use it as a tool to convene influencers or special audiences, because it's a special advanced screening or a sneak peek at something that they might not otherwise get to get. So for Inconvenient Sequel, we targeted investors, you know, the CEOs of banks and major corporations that were investing a lot of money. We did a special screening series with them, curated, followed with a panel with financial experts that were talking about the clean energy revolution and how investing in clean tech is actually a really good investment idea. So it was focused entirely at the investment opportunity for them, which was a big part of the theme of the film itself. So it tied in very strongly to the content in the movie, and it was used to help these organizations who might already be thinking about shifting their investment strategy to accelerate that decision. We also used it to help mayors who were wanting to accelerate their city's transition to clean energy, to use it as a screening tool to bring all their stakeholders together in the city, get them inspired, get them to understand the importance and why that you want to go to clean energy solutions. Again, that was a specific part of the movie for those that saw it that covered a mayor in Texas that was doing this. And then, so that's kind of the pre-release. All that impact that we're having is actually before the movie, it's actually in theaters. Once it's in theaters, we focus again very much on the empowering the individuals who are being inspired after seeing the movie to go take action. So that's where we work more closely with, I think we worked with over 10 NGOs on that movie and curated 10 different actions that individuals could take, whether it's, you know, signing a petition of some sort, whether there's a tool online to calculate your own carbon footprint and find ways to reduce it, a variety of different actions that were both sort of kind of visual, kind of, you know, you speak out, you protest actions, or behavioral change actions. And we could track that through the website in terms of seeing how many people signed up and took those actions. So 165,000 is the aggregate number of people that went to that website, to that action center, and took a concrete, specific action. So those are some of the examples of the different strategies we use for the impact campaigns. I mean, at the beginning of every campaign, we set a measurement. We set goals, very concrete goals of what we hope to accomplish with that campaign that we then hold ourselves accountable against and we measure against. Every campaign is different. It's not the same goals for everyone. You have to kind of tailor the goals to what you're trying to do, and then we revisit and see how we did when we're done. Just to wrap up on this last one quickly, the third phase is the long tail, the kind of post-release, what do you do with the movie? We tend to create these educational curriculums around our films, on many of them, where it's designed for teachers to be able to bring the film into a classroom, to be able to show the film or part of the film, and then use a lesson plan or a curriculum to teach kind of the lessons and use the film as a tool for that. So we've had great success with An Inconvenient Truth and An Inconvenient Sequel, where in many countries around the world, it's become a mandatory part of the high school curriculum. So that's, you know, in success, that's a huge opportunity. And we'll never be able to fully measure the exponential impact that things like that have. But we have a lot of, you know, certainly stories and anecdotal stories of what we hear.
Fantástico. E para finalizar, eu acho que é a pergunta que talvez vocês estejam fazendo também, e a gente se fez por muitos anos e nas nossas conversas, que é, meu Deus, então eu tenho que fazer esse tamanho de filme para conseguir me comunicar aqui no Brasil, e como é que a gente pode se beneficiar e participar desses assuntos que são tão globais, tão universais, que a gente trabalha todos os dias e que a gente não está nem sabendo o que está acontecendo em alguns outros lugares do mundo, e principalmente no trabalho de vocês, né? Então, a gente está muito feliz de hoje também poder contar uma boa notícia dessa conexão, como é que essa ponte vai ficar mais próxima também, você quer contar?
So now we're here working with Flo and Maria Farinha and Elena. We're very excited to find partners who are thinking about content the same way. They've been doing this for a long time. They've been thinking about it the same way. We've always been wanting to scale and find a way to bring our content internationally and to build these campaigns in other countries. And we're not a huge company, so we can't be on the ground in Brazil doing that. But we found an excellent, very like-minded, mission-aligned partner. And so I think we're very excited to announce, really, for the first time, that we're working together now on a lot of participants' movies here in Brazil and the rest of Latin America with Flow, which is the multi-platform distribution arm, to think about how to best bring these movies to Brazilian audience and how to build impact campaigns around them locally. Because these issues, a lot of them are very universal and global issues, but we don't have the knowledge in Brazil of how to apply that, how to use that as a tool in Brazil or in the rest of Latin America to address the specific kind of nuances of that issue that's being expressed here in Brazil. So with a partnership like this, you know, there's a couple documentaries of ours that will be coming out this year that we've now officially signed up to work together on. Flo and Maria Farinha are going to be building impact campaigns around it in partnership with Brazilian NGOs, Brazilian corporations, Brazilian governmental organizations as well, to the extent they're able to participate. It's an exciting opportunity to amplify and scale the impact that we hope to have internationally. It's a model that if it works here, we then want to take to other parts of the world, right? We can envision finding the like-minded partner in China, in India, in all kinds of, in Africa, right? And this is the beginning of that for participants, and we're really excited about it.
Esse ano a gente lança aqui no Brasil, e a gente lança o Believe Film Festival em parceria com Believe Earth, e esse recorte da nossa agenda em comum dos 17 metas do desenvolvimento sustentável. Então, a gente escolhe histórias inspiradoras, globais, diversas, muitas que vêm também da Participant para o Brasil, para a gente poder juntos co-criar campanhas híbridas que possam conectar todos os lugares, todas as plataformas, cinemas, lugares abertos, enfim, debates, que a gente possa conversar e conectar todo mundo que está aqui com essas mensagens para a gente poder espalhar isso juntos, né? Então, a gente começa hoje e conta para vocês em primeira mão que são os changemakers, né? Quem vai fazer isso na ponta junto com a gente. Então, a gente queria muito dividir com vocês, e a gente vai aproveitar esse momento para contar sobre dois filmes que a gente vai lançar e bem rapidinho, porque eu sei que está acabando, mas a gente vai mostrar dois pedacinhos para vocês de filmes que vão ser lançados esse ano já nesse recorte.
I ask no favor for my sex. All I ask of our brethren is that they take their feet off our necks.
We welcome today Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
She's become such an icon.
Would you mind signing this copy?
I am 84 years old, and everyone wants to take a picture with me.
Notorious RBG.
Yeah, yeah.
When you come right down to it, the closest thing to a superhero I know. Ruth Bader Ginsburg changed the way the world is for American women.
I became a lawyer when women were not wanted by the legal profession.
Thousands of state and federal laws discriminated on the basis of gender. She was following in the footsteps of the battle for racial equality. She wanted equal protection for women.
Men and women are persons of equal dignity, and they should count equally before the law.
She captured for the male members of the court
what it was like to be a second-class citizen.
The point is that the discriminatory line almost inevitably hurts women.
I did see myself as kind of a kindergarten teacher in those days because the judges didn't think sex discrimination existed.
I have had the great good fortune to share life with a partner truly extraordinary for his generation.
He was the first boy I ever knew who cared that I had a brain.
She is a center of power on and off the court.
Every time Justice Ginsburg wrote a dissent, the internet would explode.
I came up with a couple slogans. You can't spell truth without Ruth.
I surely would not be in this room today without the determined efforts of men and women who kept dreams alive.
I've heard that she does 20 push-ups 3 times a week or something. I mean, we can't even get off the floor. We can't even get down to the floor.
Obrigada, gente. Vocês todos estão convidados a fazer parte, construir essa campanha junto com a gente a partir desse ano, que começa em agosto, o primeiro lançamento. É, não tem tempo para perguntas, né, Mari? Não, vai. Não vejo. Obrigada, gente. Foi um prazer estar aqui com vocês. Obrigada, Gabriel, por ter vindo para o Brasil.
Muito obrigado a todos vocês.